few notes about our worship time together. As you might already know, our cantor is located up above and singing on our behalf, so we're not getting into phase of congregational singing. And the offering plates are located in the back and in our decks as you come and go. One announcement about some upcoming things. Bridges to Christ will be selling some lilac pool wreaths, hanging basket coupons starting next Sunday. And so if you'd like to come with $30, you can come and get your coupon. The baskets can then be picked up in Bergentown or Kenwood starting on May 12th. All right, so some hanging basket coupons being sold by Bridges to Christ. At this time, I invite you to stand as you're able as we give thanks for the gift of baptism.
Thanks be to God. We declare to you what was from the beginning, what we have heard, what we have seen with our eyes, what we have looked at and touched with our hands, concerning the word of life. This life was revealed, and we have seen it and testified to it, and declare to you the eternal life that was with the Father and was revealed to us. We declare to you what we have seen and heard, so that you also may have fellowship with us. And truly our fellowship is with the Father and with the Son, Jesus Christ. We are writing these things so that our joy may be complete. This is the message we have heard from Jesus Christ and proclaim it to you, that God is light, and in God there is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with God while we are walking in darkness, we lie and do not do what is true. But if we walk in the light, as God is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus the Son cleanses us from all sin. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make God a liar, and God's word is not in us. My little children, I am writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. And he is the atoning sacrifice for our sins. And not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God.
Do not doubt, but believe.
Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written, so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name. The Gospel of the Lord. It was probably just a coincidence, but Good Friday was pickup day for our recycling. It was simply just the first Friday of the month, but I prefer to think that cartels and their truck drivers thought to themselves, "Hey, Pastor Jeff is running out of certain material, especially for that second Sunday after Easter. Let's haul him out a bit. He needs a fresh take." Well, thank you, cartels, for helping me ponder anew what Holy Week and the Easter season are about recycling. When you throw your tin or aluminum cans in the bin, or set out your plastic jugs and newspaper stacks, they're taken, sorted, and cleaned. Depending on the process specific to that material, the previously used remnant is shredded or pulverized, either melted down or mixed with water or chemical alloy that will further break it down. Eventually, it is formed into molds or pellets to be reshaped into the same or a similar kind of thing to what it was before. Used, discarded, sorted, cleaned, processed, renewed. The resulting product is made from the same stuff, but has been made anew. Recycling is the story of returning an item to its intended use, of redeeming something once trashed, of taking something that started as one thing and enlivening it again with new purpose. On Good Friday, Jesus is tossed out. He is discarded like refuse. The crowd, the religious rulers, the political authorities believe that taking him outside the city, crucifying him in an act of insurrection prevention, would remove the threat of revolution. Deposited in the earth, the powers that dealt Jesus' death made him into landfill. The latest, and surely not the last, of those laid in the ground by their efforts to maintain order. Yet on Easter Sunday, it is revealed that God has made something out of their violence. The one they trashed was reclaimed from the heap, brought to life again. The crucified one becoming the crucified and risen one. God makes Jesus into the beginning of a new reclamation project that seeks to turn death into new life, despair into hope, injustice into justice, and hurt into healing. By that Easter evening, the disciples had heard that Jesus has been raised from the dead, but the entirety of its meaning still was lost on them. Instead of celebrating, they were consumed by fear of those same powers that put Jesus to death. Behind doors locked and barred, they believed themselves to be next on the docket for the gallows. Their enemy was out there, prowling around looking for them, hunting them down, seeking them out. Into this fearful room, Jesus arrives and speaks peace into their midst. Shows them just what God can do with the dead, and repurposes their fear to its opposite, forgiveness. That is surprising. The antithesis of fear is often thought to be something like courage or bravery, some form of fearlessness. For these ones, though, it wasn't fear itself that was the issue, but fear of those people out there somewhere coming for them. Those people wishing them harm. Those people. Jesus doesn't send the disciples into the world with a pep talk, making them more brave, but with a calling to forgive, to let go of this focus on those they think could do them harm. The kind of fear they are living in is what led to Jesus' scars to begin with. Setting the disciples free from fear is to remove them from the cycle where people are treated like trash, that if we want to clean up our neighborhood or city or nation, we just need to get rid of those people, that if we want to be safe, we need to defeat those people and send them into the ground and grave. It is to remove these disciples from that cycle and put them on a new path, a different cycle that doesn't operate on fear, but on forgiveness. Forgiveness is much more than letting go of any rights that you might have over someone who has wronged you. It is community with those in the wrong. We remember that throughout Scripture, forgiveness is not just granted to people who did something harmful or destructive. It was given by Jesus to those removed from community because of who they were. Blind, hungry, paralyzed, sinners, like prostitutes, tax collectors, foreigners. Forgiveness is letting go of the boundary that keeps us separate from one another, the barrier that prevents relationship, the fear that has us always expecting that we will be wronged, or polluted, or destroyed by the presence of those people. Jesus sets the disciples free from fear, setting before them in his very nail-pierced resurrected presence the possibility of a new relationship toward those who could do them wrong. Forgiveness. Of course, Thomas wasn't there when Jesus appeared. Perhaps he was sorting the recycling. In any case, he doesn't believe what he's being told, and he says he can't believe it unless he has the same experience the rest of them did. Jesus gives Thomas with the same experience. Thomas beholding a recycled Jesus, risen from the dead, bearing the wounds of his past, made of the same stuff as before, but somehow made new. Thomas's disbelief that someone was thrown out by Jesus was a person who was jumped, someone shamefully executed by the state for no life again. His recycled is transformed into belief, into trust that death is not an ending, but in God's hands can be the beginning of a new life and new purpose. Today, the risen Jesus comes into each of our rooms of fear and disbelief to transform them into something new. Our days are filled with the fear that has us treating other people like trash. Fear of a loss of freedom is leading some of our neighbors into a total disregard for human life as they refuse to mask or vaccine. A renewed rise in anti-Semitic hate groups and in violence and intimidation toward Asian Americans is rooted in that very same locked door disciple fear that people are out there who want to do us harm. People are out there who are working to destroy us in our way of life. Jesus, too, was such an object of that kind of fear. And he comes into our midst still bearing the marks of the trauma inflicted upon him to show us what fear does. But he comes not as a corpse, but as a risen one to set us free from the cycle of vengeance and violence and fear, to repurpose us for forgiveness. Our times are filled with disbelief. Disbelief that anything can be made of this refuse of a world. If we get too far gone, we are only for the trash can, not even worth a chance of recycling it. Jesus crucified and risen arrives among us to show that for God, nothing is too far gone. That all the world and you and me are all made from recyclable materials. Not one thing is beyond reclamation and redemption. The materials of hatred can be melted into love. The weapons of war pounded into instruments of peace. The designs of racism, segregation, and prejudice can be redesigned into plans of reparation and equity. Cynicism can be transformed into motivation. Envy and resentment can be collected, cleaned up, and remolded into contentment and rejoicing in the good that others receive. Fear of others can be reformed into a forgiveness that forms a community where everyone shares what they have with one another, no matter who each community member is, what they have done, or where they come from. In Easter, God is taking death and doing something with it, recycling it into life for all. God is repurposing our fear into a force for forgiveness. God is showing us that the one considered garbage, Jesus Christ, is now the first of many to be taken off the scrap heap and given new life. God is transforming our doubt that has us believing that ourselves and our world are too rotten, too beyond repair, too trash, into trust that in Jesus, everything can be recycled. Anyone can be made new. Jesus is declaring peace to us, sending us out to forgive, revealing his resurrected self to the doubtful and despairing as proof of what God can do with dead and discarded things. Saying to us, look at me. Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe.
Thank you.
Christ, by the power of the Holy Spirit, we bring our prayers before God, who promises to hear us and answer in steadfast love. You shower your church with grace, O God. Unite the whole church on earth, so that with one heart it testifies to the resurrection of Jesus Christ with power and love. Bless all servants, especially those studying to become leaders in the church, including our own Lars Anderson. Hear us, O God. You proclaim the blessing of life forevermore. Like dew upon the mountains, refresh your creation. Restore waters, cleanse the air. Provide revitalizing moisture to parched land. Give your whole creation the promise of new life. Hear us, O God. You direct the nations, O God. Guide all in authority, that they shepherd their peoples in the ways of love. Defeat in us our impulse to war. Bestow the peace of Christ upon those in authority, and breathe upon them the Holy Spirit. Hear us, O God. You place within the heart of the church a spirit of sharing. Give us the power of your generous spirit that we provide for the needs of others. Announce your peace to those who are lonely, hurting, suffering, or afraid. We pray especially for Sue Malley, Patty Pearson, Pauline Williams, Roger Erickson, Beverly Hoppe, Philip Hedges, Sonny Pauling, Matt Urnitich, Carrie Birdseye Erickson, Jamie Desmond, Ann Holacek, Clyde Erickson, and those we name in our hearts. Hear us, O God. You give us fellowship with one another in this faith community. Shine the light of the risen Christ in our life together, so that we live in love for one another and our joy may be complete. Hear us, O God. You share the gift of eternal life. In thanksgiving and remembrance, we recall the lives and gifts of those who now live in endless joy. Unite us with them in resurrection hope. Hear us, O God.
In the hope of new life in Christ, we raise our prayers to you, trusting in your never-ending goodness and mercy. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Today we commune in one time, partaking in the bread and body of Jesus. The church has taught that the full promise of Jesus' presence is known in one element, a source of comfort for those who, because of allergies or another reason, can only share the one. Today we join with them in their trust. At this time, you may retrieve your bread from the middle of your pew as we get ready to commune. Holy, mighty, and merciful Lord, heaven and earth are full of your glory. In great love, you sent to us Jesus, your Son, who reached out to heal the sick and suffering. Which good news of the Lord, while the cross opened his arms to all. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his death, resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of all who share this heavenly food, the body and blood of Jesus Christ, our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We say the bread, body of Christ, it is given for you.
Thank you. news. Hallelujah. Thanks be to God. Hallelujah.